Good morning. After the initial two articles on diabetes remission and congenital hypothyroidism, I'll be presenting the third article. I thank the organizers for having given the opportunity to give this talk here. So this article made a lot of noise, fracture prevention with zoledronate in older women with osteopenia. So it was published in New England Journal of Medicine in December 2018. Mainly the study was conducted in New Zealand. So the title of the article is Fracture Prevention with Zoledronate in Older Women with Osteopenia. It made a lot of noise because almost all the postmenopausal women have to be started on treatment. So just we know that osteoporosis is a skeletal disorder characterized by compromised bone strength predisposing to increased risk of fracture. And for bone strength, we have two main features, bone density and bone quality. So what we assess is mainly bone density. We don't assess bone quality. It's difficult to measure the bone quality. So it's a normal bone. You can see the osteoporotic bone, which is the bone strength is compromised here. So low bone mass plus microarchitectural deterioration leading on to fragility and fracture. So this is the definition of osteoporosis. But we always equate osteoporosis to low bone mass. We don't look at the microarchitectural deterioration. So bone quality is not assessed commonly. So this is how we classify the bone mineral density by DEXA scan. So normal bone density, mainly at the lumbar spine or hip, more than minus 1 is normal. Osteopenia is minus 1 to minus 2.5. And osteoporosis is less than minus 2.5. So this is how the example of a bone mineral density by DEXA scan. We use what is called as T-score. So T-score is the patient's bone density as compared to the peak adult bone mass. So Z-score is patient's bone density as compared to age and sex-matched bone density. But T-score is what is used mostly. Here you can see that if you, for bone density, here it's an osteoporosis range. T-score is around minus 3.5. So if you get here minus 2 or minus 1.5, it will be in the osteopenia range. And normal is in the green color. So this is how we do the bone mineral density and classify osteopenia or osteoporosis. So fracture risk is the main problem in postmenopausal women because of the postmenopausal osteoporosis due to estrogen deficiency. So fractures cause major morbidity and mortality and severe handicap to postmenopausal women. So osteoporosis and osteopenia are treated mainly to reduce the fracture risk. So osteoporosis, BMD T-score of less than minus 2.5 is an important risk factor for fractures. However, we need to understand that many fractures in postmenopausal women occur in those in the osteopenia range, that is BMD T-score of minus 1 to minus 2.5. Maybe the bone quality is affecting this. So the other risk factors are age, bone quality, family history, nutrition, drug intake like steroids, smoking. So these all also contribute to fracture risk on top of osteopenia. So this can be assessed by a fracture risk assessment tool called FRAX-Score. So therapies that are effective in osteopenia are needed because many women who have fractures are actually in the osteopenia range and not in the osteoporosis range. So this is a study which showed the bone density at which the fractures occur. You can see that most of the fractures here, this is a study from the USA of you can see more than 2 lakh postmenopausal women were studied. You can see the most of the fractures actually occur in the osteopenia range and not in the osteoporosis range. You can see that less than minus 2.5, this is where the most of the fractures occur, and here the number of fractures are lesser. So this is a FRAX tool, which is used on top of the bone mineral density to assess the fracture risk assessment. These are the questions, the age, sex, height and weight, fractures, previous fracture, parent with fractured hips, smoking, glucocorticoids, rheumatoid arthritis. So various risk factors are considered, and the final output is given as a 10-year risk of major osteoporotic fracture or hip fracture. So a 10-year risk of major osteoporotic fracture of more than 20% or a 10-year risk of hip fracture of more than 3% is considered as high risk for osteoporosis. So bisphosphonates for fracture risk reduction postmenopausal women, it's clearly proven in osteoporosis. There's no doubt we use it in our clinical practice. So anyone with a prior fragility fracture is considered as osteoporosis irrespective of the bone mineral density, and a BMD T score of less than minus 2.5 is considered as osteoporosis. So in this group, alendronate and zoledronic acid have clearly shown pivotal trials to reduce the fracture risk. So however, bisphosphonates for fracture prevention women with osteopenia range is not clearly proven. That's why this study was done. So this is the Horizon trial, which showed annual zoledronic acid in osteoporosis reduced the risk of hip fracture by nearly 40% and the vertebral fracture by a huge amount of nearly 77% over 3 years. So this is a pivotal trial which showed significant fracture risk reduction in the hip and the spine. So on this basis, the authors wanted to study the fracture prevention with zoledronic acid in older women with osteopenia. So the study was done mainly across various centers in New Zealand, postmenopausal women more than 65 years with osteopenia range BMD, T-score minus 1 to minus 2.5 at the lumbar spine or femoral neck were studied. So around 1,000 women were randomized to either placebo arm or zoledronate. Zoledronate was used 5 milligram every 1.5 years once, 1.5 years once for 6 years. Totally 4 doses were given. And placebo arm received normal saline once every 1.5 years. So they received calcium and vitamin D as appropriate guidelines, and they were followed up for 6 years. So the first occurrence of a fragility fracture, either a vertebral or non-vertebral fracture, was considered as the primary endpoint. And you can see that the first fragility fracture here was 37% reduction. The hazard ratio was 0.63 with the zoledronic acid. So around 37% reduction, the fracture risk was seen with the first fragility fracture over 6 years. Non-vertebral fragility fracture also, this is a placebo arm in the red color and zoledronate in the blue color, again 34% reduction. And symptomatic fracture also, around 27% reduction was there with the zoledronate arm. Change in height, height reduction was lesser with the zoledronic acid, although it's only in less than 0.5 centimeter, but it was statistically significant. So adverse events were comparable with zoledronate and placebo arm. You can see that osteonecrosis of the jaw, which is an important complication of bisphosphonates, or almost was not reported in this study. Maybe the event rate was very less. So to summarize the findings, this study showed that zoledronic acid, 5 milligram IV once in 1.5 years for 6 years, reduced fracture risk by 33% in women, postmenopausal women with osteopenia for 6 years follow-up. It was well tolerated and had a favorable safety profile. The limitations of the study, because it's a, I think if you take postmenopausal women in the osteopenia range, a huge number of postmenopausal women have to be treated. So the only problem with this study was this blind treatment of all osteopenic postmenopausal women. They did not do a fracture risk assessment using a FRAC score or other fracture assessment score. So it makes huge implications in that large number of postmenopausal women will need treatment. And nearly 25% of the enrolled women had already osteoporosis or prior non-vertebral fractures. So thereby, nearly 1/4 of the study population already had osteoporosis. So the current guidelines whom to treat to prevent fractures, this is based on the National Osteoporosis Foundation from the USA. So women with a prior fracture, a hip or vertebral fracture, all of them need to be treated with bisphosphonates. A T-score of less than minus 2.5 at the hip, lumbar spine or femoral neck need to be treated with bisphosphonates. A T-score between minus 1 to minus 2.5, that is the current study where the range was studied. They recommend treating when a 10-year probability of hip fracture of more than 3% or major osteoporotic fracture of more than 20%. That is, they recommend doing a fracture risk assessment and not blindly treat all the osteopenic women. So how to treat, so one thing is we need to ensure adequate calcium and vitamin D replacement, regular weight-bearing exercise, falls prevention strategies, muscle strengthening, avoidance of smoking and excess alcohol intake. Coming to pharmacologic therapy, we use either anti-resorptive or anti-anabolic agents. So bisphosphonates with proven fraction reduction like annual zoledronic acid is given for 3 years. After that, normally we give a drug holiday. This is the recent guideline published in the JCEM 2019 in March. This is from the Endocrine Society guideline. So they recommend all postmenopausal women, they need lifestyle and nutritional optimization for bone health, especially calcium and vitamin D. And we have to determine a 10-year fracture risk according to country-specific guidelines. So they don't recommend direct treatment for all osteopenic women. So we classify them as low to moderate risk and high to very high risk. Low risk, no bisphosphonates are there. So moderate risk or high risk, we tend to give bisphosphonates, 5 years therapy for oral and 3 years for IV. So to conclude, zoledronate for fracture prevention is recommended and must be used for osteoporosis with prior fragility fracture or BMD score of less than minus 2.5, clearly indicated, all guidelines recommend, no controversy. Coming to the osteopenia range where this study was done, BMD T score of minus 1 to minus 2.5. So current study confirms efficacy with safety. However, they did not do a fracture risk assessment. So in clinical practice, the study cannot be directly adapted to our clinical practice. We still need to individualize. We should better not to use this blindly for everyone. We need to assess fracture risk using FRAX score. Use zoledronate if high risk of fracture. Based on the FRAX tool, if you get a 10-year risk of any fracture of more than 20% or 10-year risk of hip fracture of less than 3%. Avoid zoledronate use if low risk of fracture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay, for the nice lecture. I have a basic question. I have been using zoledronate. I use it annually, 5 milligrams IV. What is the criteria of using it once in 1.5 years?
Sir, for prevention, people have also used once in 2 years also. So they say that lesser frequency use also is helpful in prevention. So for prevention, they don't want to use every yearly once.
I think there is a profound suppression of bone resorption markers in zoledronate-treated patients. And that suppression lasts for much more than a year. So I think people are trending to use it less frequently and fewer doses. Originally, it started out 5 years and now to come down to 3 or 4 doses. I think the interesting thing will be to see how many of these women develop atypical femoral fractures. There are known side effects with this.
They did not find any higher occurrence
within the short duration of follow-up. I'm sure they didn't find any, but that's one concern that will be there about use of this drug in women with osteoporosis. The risk is very small, but it does exist.
On the other side, for cancer patients, they use zoledronic acid very high dose very frequently, monthly once and 3 months once like that. They have the regimens are very strong on zoledronic acid. For prevention, they say very less frequent use. That's why they chose 1.5 years. There are studies showing even 2 years once if you use zoledronic acid is also enough, especially for prevention in osteoporosis range.
In our population, what would you think would be the major risk factors we have to take into consideration for fracture risk, you know, other than the FRX, you know, which is not possible, but what would be the main clinical features?
So other factors which need to be considered, one is we need to consider the other drug intake also, which is important. And I think calcium and vitamin D replacement should be emphasized in our setup.
Any easy method of checking for the bone quality?
Bone quality? Very poor calcium, vitamin D nutrition, which is widely prevalent in spite of abundant sunlight in India. I think that's one of the major problems. And of course, other diseases like rheumatoid arthritis and so on, which add to the risk. And iatrogenic Cushing's.
Yes.
A lot of patients are on corticosteroids for various reasons. So steroid induced would be a fairly substantial subset of patients with osteoporotic fracture in our country.
Bone quality assessment is not very easy, so they use quantitative ultrasound and three-dimensional CT, but cannot be applied in routine clinical practice.
Did they follow up these women with BMD during the 6 years? Did they do a
BMD data is not given.
It's not given.
So which one, sir? Micromillets, that there's no clinically any recommendation on the use of micromillets. Yes. Yes, it will be helpful, sir. Yes. Thank you.